Start. So it's my great pleasure to welcome all of you here today at the first panel discussion of this year's May Day School. Today our panelists are going to be talking about primitive accumulation, not as a historical description of an epoch that had started and ended long ago, but rather as a theoretical formulation, as a theoretical concept. More specifically, they'll be examining the notion of primitive accumulation as a continuous and contemporaneous process or mechanism of non-economic, that is extra-economic, capitalist accumulation. Our three speakers will have 20 minutes each to present their talk. After that, after all of them have finished, we'll move on to a discussion. I really hope it will be a lively one. That's why we're here, so please listen carefully, take some notes, and ask, comment, whatever, just engage in discussion. That's the purpose of May Day School. Okay, so here we have Henry Bernstein, Christoph Herrmann, and Sasha Furlan. I will be presenting them in more detail as we go along. And we'll start with Mr. Bernstein. His talk is titled Primitive Accumulation, What's in a Term? And Henry is an emeritus professor of development studies at the University of London School of Oriental and African Studies. He has worked for several decades on the political economy of agrarian change, social theory, peasant studies, land reform, and the rural economy in South Africa. His latest book, which deals with agrarian political economy, is Class Dynamics of Agrarian Change. Henry, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Okay, well, over 40 years ago, in an article, one of the finest Marxist scholars of my generation, Gyrus Banerjee, suggested that Marx did not construct a concept of primitive accumulation so much as describe a particular historical form of it. And Banerjee went on to warn against the persistent later confusion of different levels of analysis. And I agree with him very much. Having said that, I just want to say what a pleasure and a privilege it is to be here, and not least to be able to address an audience in my native language, English, and to say that I'm very aware of this peculiar privilege that we, who are native English speakers, can go around the world to various countries and usually be able to speak in English and to be questioned and interrogated in English by our audiences. Well, to prepare for this talk, I revisited the Marxist classics, which was very stimulating as ever, and then I read a lot of, or some of, the rapidly expanding current literature on primitive accumulation. And my feeling at the end of reading a lot of this current literature is, to quote more or less a song by Bob Dylan, is there any way out of here, said the joker to the thief. There is so much confusion, I can't get no relief. And that's my feeling about a lot of the current debate, which I'll try to explain. Seems to me there's no busier notion in Marxist and radical writing at the moment than that of primitive accumulation. It's busy in the elasticity of its definitions, its expanding range of applications, and the claims made for it. So how do we make sense of these growing claims for and debates about primitive accumulation? Well, first, I think it helps to distinguish different ways in which the concept is put to work. That's a combination of the substance given to the concept, how it is deployed, and the evidence used to illustrate or support its different uses, and much more rarely to test those uses. So different conceptualizations of primitive accumulation can be distinguished by the strength of the claims made for them, that is the type of work and the amount of work that each is called on to do. For example, is the goal to explain continuing primitive accumulation, or is primitive accumulation invoked in order to explain particular features of capitalism or capitalism as a whole. A further element that distinguishes different concepts of primitive accumulation, explicit or implicit, is the inside and outside of capitalism. I think this is very important. Typically, though not exclusively, the inside is understood as those branches and forms of production and circuits of capital characterized by the expanded reproduction of capital and often identified with societies, countries that exemplify the most advanced forms of capitalism, the North. The outside is identified by forms of production and reproduction, including their property relations and labor regimes, that are regarded in one way or another as non-capitalist, but subject to exploitation by capital, and this is usually exemplified by the global South and so on. Now, Marx's sketch of primitive accumulation gives us three kinds of dynamics. The first is the initial formation of the social conditions of capitalist production. The second is processes of expropriation centered on theft and the use of force, and both lead to the normal exploitation of wage labor by capital in time. So some brief observations on these dynamics. First of all, as Marx said, primitive accumulation is nothing else than the historical process of divorcing the producer from the means of production. In the words of my colleague Ben Fine, to create wage labor where previously it was absent. But also, and interestingly, there is some material on the creation of capital in that last part of Capital Volume 1. There are two chapters, Genesis of the Capitalist Farmer and Genesis of the Industrial Capitalist. The Genesis of the Capitalist Farmer is the briefest and, in a sense, most incomplete chapter in that last part of Capital Volume 1. And Marx describes it as a slow process evolving through many centuries in the case of England. But he also says, and I was struck by this, that the expropriation of the agricultural population creates directly none but the greatest landed proprietors, landed property capital. Therefore, something further is required for a transition to capitalist agriculture. And it's very interesting that there's a Marxist historical debate, which is still very live, about how the genesis of the capitalist farmer came about. And one of the interesting aspects of this debate, which I can only mention briefly, is that some of the authors in this debate point towards what I would call primitive accumulation from below. And that's something I'd like to just put before you, because most current ideas of primitive accumulation see it very much as something coming from above, from capital in general, or some particular form of capital. The chapter on the genesis of the industrial capitalist is interesting because it's not about industrial capitalists at all, or very little. It's about the formation of a world market from the 15th century, the period of what Marx calls the true manufacturing period, which led then to the period of modern industry from the late 18th century onwards. The second dynamic that Marx talks about is processes of expropriation centered on theft and the use of force. Now, this, it seems, is often the best remembered and most quoted part of that section on primitive accumulation in Capital Volume 1. Marx writes with graphic emphasis on the centrality and theft of, and violence, of theft and violence, to the expropriation of dynamic of primitive accumulation. And those were the sort of quotes that we saw during Michael Perelman's lecture yesterday. But then Marx also observed that the treasures captured outside Europe by undisguised looting, enslavement, and murder floated back to the mother country and were there turned into capital. Now, that's a very, very important formulation, because Marx is saying they originated in plunder, but they could only be turned into capital in Europe because the social conditions of capitalist production were already established there. And then the third dynamic, as I said, is the normal exploitation of wage labor by capital. Once primitive accumulation is complete, then capital, Marxist capital, focuses almost entirely, as you know, on the dynamics of the capitalist mode of production itself and incorporates such crucial elements as the real subsumption of labour, the appropriation of surplus, relative surplus value, as the basis of accumulation in the sense of expanded reproduction. The last of these, together with competition, drives the development of the productive forces. Now, I have no time to talk about current debates on interpreting Marx on primitive accumulation, but I'm going to structure some observations under those three headings, the three kinds of dynamics that Marx presented to us. Now, the most straightforward application of continuing primitive accumulation is as original accumulation repeated in other later historical circumstances of the emergence of capitalism, that is later than the original English transition. It's probably misleading to designate this as continuing, since what it really points to is replication of original primitive accumulation in other times and places. The major example in classic Marxism, of course, and the only fully concrete study of this process is Lenin's development of capitalism in Russia. And if you look at debates in certain areas of the South after decolonization, certainly in India in the 1950s and 1960s, the debate there was very much of this kind. How is original primitive accumulation going to be accomplished in independent India? So there was the Indian modes of production debate and so on. I just want to make some brief observations about this framing of continuing primitive accumulation as establishing the social conditions of capitalist production and accumulation. Now, it seems to me that most problematic here are uses of the term primitive accumulation simply as a label rather than an analytical tool for some kind of residual outside of capitalism. So, examples of this, which I could talk about at enormous length, but I won't, because there's no time, is ideas about the prevalence of small-scale production in the world today, especially in the South, so-called non-capitalist or traditional subsistence production, ideas of incomplete proletarianization, again, especially in the South, and ideas of the predatory appropriation of the social surplus product by dominant classes in the South through so-called non-economic or non-market means, extra-economic coercion and so on, and its non-productive uses. Now, notions like the persistence of the peasantry, which is the first illustration, support views of continuing primitive accumulation or incomplete capitalist transformation, which typically assume too rigid an interpretation of Marx's sketch of dispossession. And here I would argue that Robert Brenner's notion of the commodification of subsistence provides a more generic and surer foundation for how primitive accumulation entails the incorporation of peasants into capitalism as petty commodity producers, how the circuits of capitalist commodity relations are internalized in their household production and reproduction. So in that sense, they are inside capitalism. They're also subject to ubiquitous, if uneven, processes of class differentiation, which often takes the form of primitive accumulation from below. In connected fashion, incomplete proletarianization as an index of continuing primitive accumulation is subject to Lenin's warning against, quote, too stereotyped an understanding of the theoretical proposition that capitalism requires the free landless worker, unquote. I would argue that the growing masses of classes of labor in the world, including the reserve army and world capitalism, might not always be dispossessed of all means of reproducing themselves, but nor do they possess sufficient means to reproduce themselves other than by selling their labor power. Hence, they are also inside capitalist social relations. I move quickly on to processes of expropriation centered on theft and the use of force, the dynamic with the greatest emotive power. And it also features centrally in the two best-known arguments for ongoing primitive accumulation as inherent continuous in advanced capitalism, to use the term of Massimo De Angelis. So first, Rosa Luxemburg. I quote, "Real life has never known a self-sufficient capitalist society under the exclusive domination of the capitalist mode of production. The realization of the surplus value for the purposes of accumulation is an impossible task for a society which consists solely of workers and capitalists. Realization of the surplus value requires as its prime condition that there should be strata of buyers outside capitalist society, such social organizations or strata whose own mode of production is not capitalistic." So Luxemburg has a strong dichotomy or binary between the inside and outside of capitalism. And it shifts the consideration of primitive accumulation to the world scale. It seems to me that the model of primitive accumulation in Marx and in Lenin on Russia is primarily about national, quote unquote, paths of transition to capitalism. But what constitutes the outside is pretty elusive in Rosa Luxemburg. She doesn't define it adequately, other than as non-capitalist. And I was struck also that most of her illustrations could have been derived from Marx himself, if somewhat updated. Also, for example, for her, as for some others subsequently, household production is located outside capitalism simply by definition, which I think is an erroneous position. Luxemburg's currently most influential heir, as we know, is David Harvey, whose accumulation by dispossession sometimes seems to rest more on dispossession than accumulation, in a tradition that views primitive accumulation above all as theft rather than creating the conditions of capitalist social relations. Harvey's outside of capitalism consists of, in his words, non-capitalized assets that can be seized at very low and in some instances zero cost by capital to overcome its crisis of accumulation, above all in the current moment of neoliberal globalization. So this outside can also be inside advanced capitalism in the sense of privatization of public utilities and other industries and of social provision. And I think Harvey's principal innovation, contribution, is to open up some of the characteristic trends with advanced capitalism today, and notably its extensions of commodification, to more systematic consideration. Whether those trends represent a new round of primitive accumulation is something that I'm very skeptical about, and as are a number of the authors for the symposium in historical materialism on Harvey's book. But the strength of Luxemburg's and Harvey's claims is that they straddle both Marx's second and third dynamics. I then talk about other approaches that do likewise, one of which is the autonomist argument about spaces of enclosure and commons, but I don't have time to talk about that now. Now, let me return to another quote from Marx in his section on primitive accumulation in capital, because this is really the source of a lot of confusion and a lot of controversy, I think. Marx said that the organization of the capitalist process of production, once fully developed, breaks down all resistance. The dull compulsion of economic relations completes subjection of the laborer to the capitalist. Direct force outside economic conditions is, of course, still used, but only exceptionally. The worker's dependence on capital is guaranteed in perpetuity by the conditions of production themselves. Now, so there's a kind of normalization that Marx pointed to. This is rife for disagreement and, indeed, I think, for confusion. I just have to turn the page here. And this is the source of all those accusations against Marx, rejections of Marx, claiming that Marx is theological, economistic, deterministic, and so on. And a very interesting and very problematic issue, I think, for Marxists, which is that Marx, and I think Lenin later, writing about Russia in the 1890s, both saw primitive accumulation as, in a sense, progressive, because it was creating the conditions of a more advanced form of mode of production and so on. Now, it seems to me that for Marx, the whole point about the freedom of wage labour, once established by dispossession, is that the social relations of the capitalist production process do not require any extra economic coercion of labour intrinsic to production, as in slavery, feudalism, and so on. On the other hand, does this fundamental aspect of the necessarily abstract theory of the capitalist mode of production imply that the concrete trajectories of accumulation to the present day are unmarked by coercion and violence, or that there is no political that underpins the economic processes of capitalism, or that the theory of the mode of production does not require a theory of the capitalist state, or that the histories of accumulation do not require analysis of the formation, functioning, and activities of states, of the uneven course of class and popular struggles. Now, this seems to me a very bizarre conclusion to attribute to Marx, and is the effect, surely, of transposing in stereotypical fashion, to use Lenin's term again, the abstractions of capital directly to the terrain of empirical concrete analysis. Rather, concrete analysis always entails the concentration of many determinations, in Marx's terms, to grasp capital's histories in all their contradictions, their specificities, their different patterns, rhythms, fluctuations, and their violence. And in fact, this morning we had an excellent example in Lev's presentation of a concrete analysis of a concrete situation. So, in a way, I am skeptical about this renewal of interest in primitive accumulation, how it's applied to capitalism today. The key question, I think, is raised in a very good recent article by Derek Hall, who says, what is it that the concept of primitive accumulation can give us that other concepts cannot? And I think it would be a good experiment to try to analyze some of these developments, undoubted trends in contemporary capitalism, which are grouped together as continuing primitive accumulation or as accumulation by dispossession, and see if we can analyze them without using those terms. That would be the real test of what they are adding, if anything, to our analysis of dynamics of contemporary capitalism. I've got several examples short examples I've got here, but perhaps I shall save that for the discussion, because I'm conscious that I don't want to deny my other comrades here of time to present their thoughts.
Thank you, Henry. Okay, next up we have Christoph Herrmann. His talk is titled Primitive Accumulation or Accumulation or Commodification. Christoph is a senior researcher at the Working Life Research Center in Vienna. He is a lecturer at the University of Vienna and currently a visiting professor at the Berlin School of Economics and Law. His research interests include Marxism, political economy, and neoliberalism, and he is one of the authors and editors of the book titled Privatization of Public Services. Christoph, you're up.
Okay. What I'm going to do is follow Henry's lead in the sense of criticizing the concept of primitive accumulation, but with a more specific focus on privatization of public services. This way? Okay. Mm-hmm. As Henry mentioned, what we have seen in recent years is this renewed interest in the concept of primitive accumulation, and especially, I think, in David Harvey's interpretation as accumulation by dispossession. One reason, of course, is the ongoing privatization of public services in Europe and beyond, specifically fueled in the current crisis by the crisis in Southern Europe, where privatization of public property and public services was demanded by the European Commission and the Troika as part of the memorandum of understandings that the governments had to send for the rescue money. as Harvey notes, with reference to privatization, the corporatization and privatization of hitherto public assets like universities, to say nothing of the wave of privatization of water and other public utility that has swept the world, constitute a new wave of enclosing the commons. Harvey then, Henry already mentioned, referencing Rosa Luxemburg, argues that violent forms of accumulation are not limited to the early stage of capitalist development, but remain the defining feature of capitalism over the centuries up until today. However, what Harvey says is this accumulation of dispossession are of different importance in different phases of capitalist development. So what we have seen in the post-war decade, we had a form of accumulation that was characterized by a massive expansion of what Marx and Harvey also call expanded reproduction, based mainly on this link between mass production and mass consumption. The regulation series called for the 40s. When this system went into crisis in the 70s, according to Harvey, then the dominant pattern of accumulation shifted from expanded reproduction to accumulation by dispossession, with privatization opening up vast fields of over-accumulated capital to seize upon. Following Harvey's, a number of scholars have used the concept and described the sale of public water system, the corporatization of public hospitals, or the commercialization of public universities as examples of accumulation by dispossession. I think there are two reasons, or that we can make two arguments why this concept of accumulation by dispossession is attractive, and there is some justification to use it. First, I think importantly, it gives Marxists the possibility to leave the narrow framework of not mainstream economics and to avoid the related debates about efficiency. If you go into mainstream literature on privatization, the whole question is, are private providers more efficient than public providers? And you have case studies after case studies that some say they are, others say they are not. That's the whole debate that goes on about privatization in mainstream economics, and this concept allows us to go behind that and also show that there's something more fundamental going on when public services are privatized. A second important advantage is not analytically but politically. I think it's a very good slogan, and it was used by social movements, especially in the South, to stage struggles against privatization, right? So it has a political value that we should not underestimate. However, I think that there are also a number of problems with this concept, because I think it tends to obscure or at least downplay a number of interesting aspects that are characteristic for privatization processes. And here I can think of at least three such aspects. The first one is that privatization is not only an act of dispossession. The new private owners of these privatized organization companies, whatever, do not just take over a public organization and continue to provide the service. In fact, a number of these privatized companies, as we also know here in Central Eastern Europe, were loss-making before they were taken over by the new private investors. Would be, for example, also is the case for a number of postal offices, and probably the U.S. mail at the current stage is also a loss-making company. However, what the new private owners then do is they immediately change the system of production, the mode of production, how the service is produced. And also, importantly, they change the organization of work. And secondly, at the same time, they also change the content and supply of these services in order to make them profitable. Right? I'll say a little bit about that in my second part of the prioritization. The second important weakness of the concept is that changes in product, this privatization that then unleashes changes in production systems that are linked to a transformation of employment and working conditions of those who produce these services in their daily work. Privatization typically results in a reduction of employment. You're well aware of that, that in the postal service, for example, privatized postal companies lay off about a third, between a third and 50% of the workers. What they do immediately, then they have wage cuts, longer, more flexible working hours, and an intensification of work. In other words, the process of privatization can hardly be separated from a drive towards maximizing surplus labor. And this maximizing surplus labor is, of course, one of the fundamental characteristics of expanded reproduction as described by Marx. A third weakness is, I also think, if we use the concept of accumulation by dispossession, is that it hides that the sale of public goods or services is only one form of privatization. And so what Harvey describes as dispossession, there are many forms. What we usually associate when we talk about privatization that has not necessarily something to do with a transfer of ownership and owner rights, the assets themselves. There are forms of outsourcing, public-private partnerships, private finance initiatives, only to mention some of them. What is also important is that in many cases, at least here in Europe, is that there is a process of marketization that precedes the actual privatization. In Europe, for example, the policies of the European Union, of the European Commission, is never until recently now, we have a different situation with the memorandum of understanding, but until then, all they did is promote liberalization. The European Commission would tell you, if you talk to them, they never forced one member state to privatize anything. All that they did is they forced them to abolish public monopolies. But this then, of course, entailed a process where the member states started to sell off public assets. But still, this marketization, corporatization, I think it's different. And we have to be aware that there are different dynamics at work. And especially when we, coming back to Harvey's earlier quote, when he talks about healthcare and education, what we really have in healthcare and education is much more of this process of marketization and corporatization than privatization. We have in Europe, we only have one country that has systematically privatized public hospitals. And not many people know that. This country is Germany. We have some, now in Britain now, that the first public hospital was privatized in Britain, and we have some cases, one case in Sweden and some cases in other countries. But we have a systematic transformation of healthcare in the sense that it's marketized. What I think, which is a much more useful concept to think about the changes, is to use this notion or concept of commodification. As Henry also already mentioned, I think this allows us to understand the variety of forms of privatization associated process, as well as what's then happening with the services and with those who uses these services. So So now I would say would like to say a bit about what I understand as commodification, which is not that easy as we would think. Despite frequent references to commodification in Marxist and other critical literature, there is, in my view, surprisingly few contributions to a socialist theory of commodification. Also, Marx himself did not use the term commodification. He described two major processes that later on were associated with commodification. First, the conversion of common land into privately owned land, what we usually discuss as the process of primitive accumulation, and then the transformation of an independent producers into a class of rich laborers that are dependent on the sale of their labor power or the creation of the working class. Karl Polanyi took the issue further and provided a detailed account of the historical processes that led to the establishment of markets for labor, land, and money. Writing after the Great Depression of the 1870s, after the Great Depression, Polanyi concluded that humanity must be protected from the disastrous effects of self-regulated markets. The restriction of market forces has subsequently been described as process of decommodification. And here, one important author at that time, more radical and to the left, Gösta Espin Andersson, for example, defined decommodification as emancipation from market dependency. I think markets, of course, they play a crucial role in commodification processes, but I think commodification is more than marketization. Commodification describes a process in which use values are subjugated to exchange values, or as Marx mentioned, stated at one part, exchange values come to direct use values. The creation of market relations and the promotion of competition are part of this process, but to fully subordinate use values to exchange values, a second condition must be met: the existence of private, individual, profit-maximizing interests. In other words, it is not enough that goods and services are produced for sale. They must be produced and sold in a way to ensure the highest possible profit for capital owners. Unfortunately, I don't have time to go deeper into that, but these distinctions between market, the establishment of market relations and private property then allows us to kind of map all the different versions and forms of privatization as specific forms of commodification. And I think also that it plays an important role in the Brenner debate, the question if there was markets before we had private property or the other way around. What I think is what we then have to, or the next step, if we understand commodification in this way, it not only allows us to kind of link different processes that we have out there, but this process of subjugation of use value to exchange value then also allows us to explain a number of developments that are typical for privatization processes. And I'll just mention a couple of them. The first one, and this is, by the way, this is based on a large empirical study we did in a European research project where we went into companies and did interviews and found out that a lot more is going on than what mainstream economic theory would tell you. These privatization processes unleash much more than the questions of efficiency and quality. One is that immediately private owners of public services, they try to maximize exchange value by limiting competition through mergers and acquisitions that allows them to maintain or increase prices. If you take the liberalized electricity sector in Europe that we have now, there are five companies that dominate the electricity, the liberalized electricity sector in Europe. Another aspect of that is that they start to invest in other profitable businesses and in other countries and get engaged in all things, not least financialization and financial assets and trying to make money on the stock market. Another strategy is how they try to maximize exchange value is the altering of the focus and the scope of services. Commodification encourages service providers to focus on financially important customers. These are either particularly large, or mostly large enterprises, or particularly lucrative clients, usually wealthy in individuals. One aspect here, or closely related to this, are also changes in the scope of services. Providers maximize exchange value by reducing or eliminating those services or service aspects which yield the smallest profit or make losses. The first thing is to focus on lucrative clients, for example, is to open new universities where the students have to pay fees for students that from wealthy families that can afford them. An example for large clients is in the postal market. The Amazon, for example, has a different way. A lot of the postal companies, they focus their business on retailers like Amazon, and the regular client, like we are, it's not important for them anymore. And also related to that, the closing down of post offices in rural areas, right? And new providers don't even bother about delivering mail into a village in the Austrian Alps, for example. A second set of changes then deliberately modifies use values in order to maximize exchange values. Here, an interesting development is that contrary to the promise of greater choice, privatization typically involves a process of standardization. Faced with competition, what the new providers do is they try to reduce cost by standardizing processes and output. And by the way, an interesting observation that comes here also into play is Rustin Veblen, for example, and he described the underlying dynamics with regard to the commodification of US universities in the early 20th century. He says, as soon as the education becomes a merchantable good, it is rated, bought, and sold by standard units, measured, counted, and reduced to staple equivalents by impersonal mechanical tests. And I think it's very much what we see when we see the transformation of universities, what we the commodification of education. This is much as part of this process. The last very important aspect is, of course, then also that the commodification of public services also demands for a commodification of public service work. It was never fully decommodified in the sense that public sector workers, of course, they were selling their labor power for a wage. They had extraordinary or comparable high degree of job security, stable employment relations, life careers, and also the work was regulated by standards that were not influenced or imposed by the need to outcompete competitors. So I would have like whenever I have more time to go more a bit deeper into that. Just if I have one more minute, is that okay? I think what is the conclusion? I think that commodification entails a far-reaching transformation of the provision of public services. that goes beyond the scope of mainstream economic theory, but also goes further than the concept of primitive accumulation or accumulation of dispossession tells us. I think perhaps primitive accumulation can be understood the first step in a much longer and encompassing commodification process. And I think politically it's important to use this concept of commodification for two reasons. The first reason is following up with the previous speaker in the morning told us, I think it's important to promote and strengthen all forms of decommodification, right? And we can talk about that. But as a second aspect, I also think it's important to think about modes of ways how we can maximize use value rather than exchange value. And that as an important challenge for a radical left in a transition to a non-capitalist society.
Thank you, Christoph. Okay, next up we have Sasha Furlan. His talk is titled On the Production and Reproduction of the Capital Relation. He is a student of political science at the Faculty of Social Sciences in Ljubljana. He is a member of the Workers' and Punks' University and a researcher at the Institute of Labor Studies. Sasha.
Okay, thank you. So today I'll be talking about some of the ambiguities of Marx's concept of primitive accumulation on a rather abstract theoretical level, so I won't be dealing with particular empirical cases of primitive accumulation, but I'll be interested in the depiction of the logic of primitive accumulation as such. I'll try to basically address some problems that arise when we try to distinguish between the logic of what we could call capitalist accumulation proper on the one hand and primitive accumulation on the other hand. And are primarily concerned with the question of how accumulation of capital as such and primitive accumulation interact in the process of expanded reproduction of capital. First I will just start with the depiction of two currents of explanation, sort of two distinct takes on primitive accumulation as a concept in Marxist literature. The first current basically described primitive accumulation as a historical process that took place in the distant past in the period of transition from feudalism to capitalism. And this orthodox interpretation or traditional interpretation, as Massimo De Angelis would have called it, uses the concept exclusively to describe the historical process of the separation of people from their means of production, or their means of subsistence that started in Western Europe in the late Middle Ages and ended somewhere in the early 19th century when capitalism finally triumphed and prevailed. It's primarily focused on the initial formation of the working class, a formation of a population with no other means of livelihood but their labor power on the one hand, and the creation of the capitalist class, a class that has a monopoly on the means of production on the other hand. This process was described as something that could only be achieved by extra-economic violence, and this common interpretation was held by Lenin and also Rosa Luxemburg, even though Rosa Luxemburg later influenced some of the interpretations that departed from this traditional interpretation, and it was also held by some of the most influential Western Marxists of the 20th century, such as Paul Sweezy and Maurice Daube. This proposition, the primitive accumulation, only designates the process of transition from feudalism to capitalism. If we take this view, basically the problem arises when we try to analyze the formation of capitalist class relations of production on the global scale. If we focus exclusively on England, as Marx did in his illustration of primitive accumulation in Capital Volume 1, then of course we can say that the process started in the late Middle Ages and ended in the early 19th century. But when we take into consideration other parts of the world, we are confronted with a problem in drawing a close time interval of the process of primitive accumulation, simply because primitive accumulation appeared in different countries at different times. So, and it's also a fact that in various parts of the world, feudal type relations of production existed well into the 20th century, and it's basically also a fact that even though capitalism is the dominant global mode of production, in various parts of the world, non-capitalist relations of production exist up to this day, even though they are rather marginal. Okay, so the other current of interpretations avoids those difficulties by stressing the continuous character of primitive accumulation. This alternative interpretation is shared by various authors. We've already heard about them, such as David Harvey, also Massimo De Angelis, Werner Bonnefeld, Giovanni Arrighi, for example. Also, this interpretation indicates that separation of populations from the means of production or subsistence achieved through extra-economic violence is a continuous process that is constantly at work up to this day, and that this process is inherent to the logic of capitalist production. So, before I go to the depiction of this logic, I'll just briefly summarize how the concept of primitive accumulation is introduced and defined by Marx in the chapter of the so-called primitive accumulation, Capital, Volume 1. So after he has dealt with the analysis of accumulation of capital proper, of accumulation of capital as such, Marx stresses the necessity to address the material preconditions of this accumulation. So he states that capitalist accumulation presupposes surplus value presupposes capitalistic production, capitalistic production presupposes the pre-existence of considerable masses of capital and of labor power in the hands of producers of commodities. So the whole movement therefore seems to turn in a vicious circle out of which we can only get by supposing primitive accumulation preceding capitalistic accumulation. So capitalist accumulation, based on what Marx called the capital relation, therefore presupposes separation between the workers and the ownership of the conditions for the realization of their labor. So the essence of primitive accumulation is this separation. Separation of the producer from the means of production, and this separation is crucial and constitutive to the concept of capital. Capital, which is by Marx considered as a social relation and basically as a class relation. So Massimo De Angelis and Werner Bonnefeld have, I think, correctly pointed out that this separation of the producer from his or her means of production, that is crucial and decisive element of primitive accumulation, is also constitutive for capitalist accumulation as such. So this point of view was basically shared by Marx also, because in many places in Capital Volume 1, Capital Volume 3, also in Theories of Surplus Value, and in Grundrisse, he explicitly states that this separation that was achieved by primitive accumulation has to be constantly reproduced within the process of capitalist accumulation as such. So if the essence of primitive accumulation is the formation of the capital relation, the essence of accumulation of capital is the reproduction of this capital relation. So capital as self-valorizing value basically reproduces itself by reproducing this capital relation, while this relation is reproduced by means of constant reproduction of this separation of the producers from their means of production. So, even though the same separation lies at the core of primitive accumulation as well as at the core of capitalist accumulation proper, we can't, of course, simply equate them. The decisive distinction is that the former creates the capital relation while the latter reproduces this relation. But as I'll try to show, this distinction becomes blurred when we address the dynamics of expanded reproduction of capital, which presupposes accumulation of capital on an ever wider scale. So the distinction between accumulation proper and primitive accumulation is somewhat easy to depict when we consider capitalist accumulation within the framework of simple reproduction of capital. So this consideration presupposes the existence of capital relation already achieved by primitive accumulation, which only has to be reproduced by means of accumulation on the same scale. So it does not presuppose any expansion or any new creation of the capital relation. But as soon as we take into consideration expanded reproduction of capital that is based on accumulation of capital on an ever wider scale, the distinction between accumulation proper and primitive accumulation becomes ever harder to pick, because within the framework of expanded production, the reproduction of the capital relation in many cases coincides with the creation of capital relation anew, simply because this reproduction has to be made at an increasing scale. So reproduction of capital relation at this moment cannot be distinguished from the production of this relation. So primitive accumulation is thus in a way subsumed under capitalist accumulation proper as one of its constitutive moments. So accumulation and primitive accumulation are in a certain context at some point like basically two distinct sets with an intersection in which they coincide. So capitalist accumulation on an expanded scale at a certain point can only be achieved by means of, say, extra economic violence, by primitive accumulation, actually. So if we read, for example, Capital Volume 1, this is implicit already before we come to the chapter on the so-called primitive accumulation, already when Marx discusses the general law of capitalist accumulation. He states that the increase of accumulation, at least if we presuppose that the composition of capital is constant, will basically be accompanied by the increase in the demand for labor power. And large-scale accumulation thus presupposes basically a large reserve army of unemployed, a large army of population separated from the means of production that are not always simply there, but have to be somehow created and recreated. So maybe the depiction of this logic can maybe or maybe not shed some light to the contemporary debates on the continuous character of primitive accumulation. For example, also already mentioned debates around Harvey's concept of accumulation by dispossession, which are, I think, here symptomatic. The concept was, of course, advanced by Harvey in his book New Imperialism in order to describe contemporary phenomena of expropriation of the means of production. So Harvey includes under his term various different contemporary processes, such as acquisition of agricultural land for non-agricultural purposes, or displacement of peasant cultivators for corporate farming, or privatization of common property resources, privatization of previously nationalized industries, process of structured asset destruction through the process of financialization, and so on, and so on. So critiques of Harvey were later made by Robert Brenner and also by Ben Fine. They claim that Harvey's concept is basically inflated out of existence, that it's simply too expansive, which is, I think, true in a way, since it collects in the term under this umbrella, collects under this umbrella term unduly diverse factors. But Brenner stressed out that, for example, the phenomena of mergers and acquisitions that are described by Harvey as acts of accumulation by dispossession are actually nothing but moments of centralization of capital, which is a product of the normal expanded reproduction of capital itself. But my contribution to this debate would be basically to claim that both Brenner and Harvey, while referring to such an empirical phenomena, are basically right. I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm not proposing any kind of obscure quasi-dialectics. I'm not trying to claim that two opposite views are both right. What I'm trying to say that according to the previously described logic of accumulation of capital in the framework of expanded reproduction, in which capitalist accumulation and primitive accumulation can coincide, we can say that the same empirical phenomena, such as concentration of capital, is in a certain context an act of capital accumulation proper, as well as an act of primitive accumulation. So this confusion or conflation of terms that arises when you try to find out if a certain particular phenomenon is an act of primitive accumulation or ordinary accumulation, basically has some of its origins in reality itself, in the logic of capital accumulation, which at a certain point can coincide and not cannot be clearly distinguished from primitive accumulation as such.
Okay, so now we have time for discussion. We will take some questions, please, and then I'll let the speakers interact with each other, because I've seen a lot of scribbling down as they were talking. So please raise your hands and my colleagues will deliver the microphones to you. Okay, hands. Okay.
I would like to come to the central issue of being South European region. I mean, I think one of the peculiarities of that region is that there has been twice a process of ursprüngliche Appopulation in the sense of being ursprünglich, original. It has been one process in the 19th century, and I would say again in the early 1990s, arguing that, I mean, state socialism was not capitalist. It was not a capitalist class, it was not valorization of capital. And this transformation or restoration of capitalism created again a class of capitalists. So far, I would say there was an original creation again. And what I think is a tricky question is the question of the direct producers, you know, that were formerly part of the social, they were owners of the so-called social property in Yugoslavia, and even in a more abstract form of state property in the other state socialist countries. Though, I mean, that status had only very limited practical consequences. I mean, they could not be fired. That was a practical consequence in most countries. Yugoslavia was substantial agriculture. Yugoslavia was a bit different. That certain power at the shop floor, but I mean, not moving beyond that. On the use of the surplus, they had no influence at all. Well, that was decided partially by the central planning administration and in Yugoslavia partially as well by the directors of the socialist enterprises. And in a way they had already been liberated from their means of subsistence. I mean, that had happened. Really happened before. So far, I would say that this process in that region in the 1990s does have its own peculiarities, though I would argue that in the early 1990s the notion of original accumulation is a pertinent one. It cannot be totally equated with earlier processes in the 19th century. Processes, let's say, in sub-Saharan Africa today.
Okay, so will any of you respond to this? I don't think we should take another question because this was a pretty complex one. Anyone? Okay, another question?
I don't want to go at length into the whole question because I'll be talking about, you know, my view on this issue in a few days. But I think that Sasso's point about the link between expanded reproduction and primitive accumulation is a very interesting one and important to make. But if the two are intrinsically linked, why doesn't Marx include it in his discussion of expanded reproduction? You know, why is it separate? And in general, the general question that I would ask is, why is the whole discussion of primitive accumulation put at the end of the book, after the discussion of accumulation as such?
Again, any comments?
Okay, first, okay, the last question, why is it put at the end of the book? I think basically Marx dynamics of his analysis is based basically that he starts actually with the laws of capitalist accumulation. I mean, his method of historical materialism, so to say, is not such that he would start with, I don't know, concrete development of capitalism in a way. I mean, he wouldn't want to describe how capitalism came into power in concrete history, but first, basically, he tried to depict the logic of how capitalism works, but then address the material preconditions of this logic. So this, I mean, there are a lot of different readings of Capital also. I mean, of the first three chapters, for example, they were seen by some authors as a depiction of a historical development of capitalism, while by other authors they were seen as basically just basics for the description of the dynamics of capitalism, of already existing capitalism as such. But I don't know why Marx does not mention actually the primitive accumulation when he discusses expanded reproduction of capital. I mean, he basically does mention it a lot of times. I mean, he refers to it and he says that, okay, this separation that was made by means of primitive accumulation has to be reproduced on an expanded scale. At least, I mean, the same separation that was made by primitive accumulation has to be reproduced. And I mean, in this way, he does mention it.
Okay, Harry?
Yeah, I'd like to use that question or abuse it to just say a few other things quickly. As I mentioned, there's this tremendous debate on the relation between theory and history and capital itself. In Harvey's companion to reading Capital Volume 1, he is fairly dismissive of the historical passages in Capital Volume 1. And indeed, he uses his discussion of the last part of Volume 1 on primitive accumulation as a springboard for putting forward his own idea of continuing primitive accumulation or accumulation by dispossession. In his book, The New Imperialism, he notes, and usefully, that actually in that short last section of Capital Volume 1, Marx points to eight different processes which are grouped by Marx there and termed primitive accumulation. And there are these so-called aleatory readings of primitive accumulation in the last part of Capital, which try to unpack it more as theoretically informed history, which therefore can go in somewhat different directions. Now, something I think is very important and is, you know, a central point of Michael Perelman's book, which he also talked about yesterday to some extent, is that for Marx, doing a critique of political economy, it was important to confront Adam Smith and others on the idea of this kind of smooth and painless birth of capitalism. But it is more complicated than that because, as Michael said yesterday, he doesn't like Adam Smith, fair enough. But, you know, if you look at the discussion of Adam Smith as a theorist in, for example, David McNally's book on the history of political economy, it's a much more extensive sort of discussion. And seeing that somebody mentioned Giovanni Arrighi, who was such a wonderful political economist, more or less of my generation, a bit older, and also one with a good sense of humor, Arrighi drew on Adam Smith, was inspired by Adam Smith, as he makes clear in his account of China. The book is called Adam Smith in Beijing, and the reason Arrighi claims this inspiration by Smith is that Smith provided the basis of a model of what? Accumulation without dispossession. That actually is the twist and possibly to some extent the joke in Arrighi's account, but he takes Adam Smith very seriously and attempts to use him as a basis of a model of economic change, economic development, which Arrighi calls a non-capitalist market-based model. Capitalism, you need primitive accumulation to start. According to Arrighi, you don't need primitive accumulation for a non-capitalist market model, which he argues had developed in Chinese history by the early modern period and is now, in a very peculiar sense, has been resumed, in his view, in contemporary China. So I'm mentioning those things because they just indicate to us levels of complexity and why, as I said at the beginning, quoting Bob Dylan, sometimes there seems to be so much confusion. How does one get out of here? I'll just mention finally, David McNally's latest book, very stimulating book called Monsters of the Market, actually has, it's not very long, but it's an important part of his book, an argument about the relationship between more abstract theory and capital and those passages, historical passages included, where Marx writes about the experience, the experiences, especially the experiences of the dispossessed and of workers of capitalism. And he suggests that they have a very definite relationship, which would imply that the section on primitive accumulation is not just stuck on to the end of volume one. It certainly looks like that, I agree, but that it has another purpose in the overall structure and style of volume one. And that's what, I don't think David's arrived yet, has he? But I think that's a reasonable presentation of what he says in this new book on Monsters of the Market.
Just to Joachim, I don't think that we would contest that in this particular historical phase, you actually have something like, of course, from a non-capitalist economy to transform into a capitalist economy, you need something like an original, a primitive accumulation. The problem is only, and I don't think we would disagree, that it's different when we then talk about the accumulation of dispossession in universities. That makes that's something different, and it's much more problematic, and it doesn't really, what should that mean? It's a good political slogan to oppose the dispossession of education. But what it doesn't tell us a lot what's really happening in the universities. Because I don't know the exact situation here in Slovenia, but in very few countries, public universities are privatized. That's not what's happening. They introduce all kind of processes of standardization to make them to change them, right? But that would be at least my critique, and I don't think that any of us would disagree with your analysis of the situation here in the United States.
Okay, other questions?
Here is one. I want to try to give just two comments and questions. And I would like to criticize this alternative in concept of commodification that you give to primitive accumulation. That doesn't mean I think that primitive accumulation is really a politically smart concept to use, but two things. First, when we look at what Marx wants with primitive accumulation, and I think this interpretation is fair enough, we see him first on many pages working out the dialectical inference of forms needed to have commodity production. And then he asks himself in the so-called primitive accumulation chapter, how in, I would say that that is his question, how in historical situation of feudalism is it possible to for these necessary forms to emerge? How is it possible to have these forms emergent so that we have the commodity production, so that we have capitalism? And now, if we want to use the concept of commodification, I think we need to put it in such a strong, necessary context. We have to show how in the dialectical inference of commodity production, we would put the commodification as a concept. Where and why is it necessary for the production of commodities? I'm not sure that it is possible. I think that Marx was had very good arguments for showing why the primitive accumulation is necessary for these forms to emerge. But I'm not sure that we can do that with commodification. That would be one critique for that concept. And the other one, I agree, and I understand the points that you made about in what way primitive accumulation ignores the elements that are now happening with privatization of public sector and everything. But I think there is a main one line that is really there, and we have to acknowledge it, and that would give us the foundations to talk about primitive accumulation today in privatizing of public sector. And this is the line. We know that now in this privatization of public sector, we don't have or at most parts we don't have new workers emerging with dispossession in Western countries. When you privatize medical sector or educational sector, you don't have new workers emerging as in enclosing the fields in Britain and everything. But on the other hand, you have the change that something what was socially guaranteed and what was free, the medical care, the education, is now has a price, and you have to buy it. And that makes the worker pushes worker to work more so that he can earn enough to finance his health, his education, and everything. And in that way, it is parallel to the normal case of primitive accumulation described by Marx, because you have the way to push worker to work more. That is in a way similar to push someone who was in feudal relations to go out to market. I think there is a parallel, and also there is another parallel. If we accept that in the 70s the profit rate fell, we don't need to, but if we do, then we can say that that capital accumulation proper couldn't work anymore in the West, and then we can say that this privatization of public sector was a kind of primitive accumulation, because it opened the spaces that enabled the proper capitalist accumulation to work once again. And that would be two arguments why the concept of primitive accumulation could be used in a substantial way to understand not all, maybe all aspects of what is happening in privatization of public sector, but maybe some really, really, really important ones.
Any responses? Yes?
The first thing, I didn't really get your argument, because you can, the creation of the working class, can you describe that as part of primitive accumulation or as commodification of labor power? I don't see a reason why we can't just use commodification of labor power. The commodification of labor power as a fundamental condition for capitalism to develop and grow, and so I'm not so sure but it's also a very theoretical debate, because what what can we conclude for the situation today? The second argument was, if I understand you correctly, if you kind of privatize healthcare, you force the workers to work more. You can do that by just paying them lower wages. You don't have to privatize healthcare to do that. And that's what they do currently, for example, in Southern Europe. They forcefully reduce wages, force workers to work more. It's that. I think there is much more at stake here. I think when you commodify healthcare, you change the perception of the people. That's much more than primitive accumulation can tell you. What it is you change the expectations of people. What the society, what the state can expect from the public to deliver to them, right? So that's why I think commodification is so much more useful because if you go to the universities, right? With the commodification of universities, the first thing is students are now coming and they think it's like they are buying something. They go and not go to the university and study. Right? And this has all kinds of implications, and they don't no longer what they do is to complain if something doesn't work or if they are not satisfied, but they don't think about taking over the universities and becoming involved in running the university. In Austria, we used to have that until 2000 that the student body was involved in some way in administering university. It was the reforms, of course, they got rid of that. Now the students, my students, they don't even think about that it would be a possibility, not just complain about the situation, but actually do something in the sense that they become responsible and run the university. So there's much more at stake there, in the sense, another important effect, which unfortunately I didn't have time to talk about it, is if you think about the commodification of healthcare and education, an hugely important effect is that you increase differences. So that you undermine the little of solidarity that we still have in our society. One excellent example is the National Health Service, what you have in Britain and the attack on the National Health Service. The National Health Service is probably the last thing in Britain where it's expression not only of a common good, but also of solidarity in the sense that, for example, in Britain, even if you're a foreigner and come to the country and you need to go to a hospital, you can just go to the hospital. Right? It's this idea in the age of this increasing racism and anti-migration sentiments, I found still fascinating, and they are doing that very quickly. Another debate, which probably there are panels which I'm not very happy with, is this idea of the commons. I have to tell you, it makes sense in certain aspects, but and for public services, it doesn't make sense. The reason is because it's you give the impression that there is a health service and you just have to go there and get treated. What we really have a huge organization, we have a process, these things have to be produced, delivered, there are workers involved, and what makes it a particular as for bioethics, it's this notion of the commons is particularly problematic is because there are decisions to be made. There are collective decisions. If you want to, for example, have the best medical care, as you have, for example, in the United States, in some places, for a limited number of people, or you want to have a more equal, effective healthcare system like you have in Cuba, for example. There are decisions to be made. It's not like you just go there and take it. I mean, that works for the internet and for certain public fields. But it's what I wanted to also hint to at the end of my presentation. The crucial question is how we maximize use value. How we going to do that? And running a healthcare system is about maximizing use value for those who need it. And it's not just going there and take what you need.
I think your points were very, very good ones, indeed. But I'd go back to the question, what do we actually gain analytically by calling those instances of primitive accumulation? I mean, is this incredibly emotive term? Obviously, is what it's all about. Also, it strikes me, I'm just throwing this in for provocative effect, that if we look at the history of capitalism, it may seem that retrospectively its principal moment of welfareism so far, that is in Western Europe certainly, would seem to be the anomaly in the longer history of capitalism, a very particular moment that we can try and understand and historically and so on, because of the nature of class struggle and so on, and also during this extraordinarily expansive, the so-called golden period, rather than a normality which is now being reversed by so-called primitive accumulation. And I just wanted to add something about, I mean, obviously we can assume, rightly so, that in a very general and generic sense, capital has an interest in disciplining wage labor. One of the ways in which it does so, which Marx wrote about, of course, was through the mechanisms of the reserve army of labor. However, it seems to me one of the problems about the primitive accumulation literature today, and not only that, is that it implicitly has a kind of functionalist explanation. Now, it seems to me that it's absolutely clear that the reserve army of labor is currently growing, you know, throughout the world. But it's not clear to me that this represents some well-defined or well-understood intention or purpose of capital. A lot of things happen in capitalism that are an effect of the contradictions of capitalism. Then they don't happen because they serve the interests of capital. And that is a functionalist view that I think is very problematic in a lot of Marxist analysis. I'll just give you quickly two quotes from other people. One is from a proposal for a new book by two anthropologists, but they think very big, James Ferguson and Tanya Lee. And their book is called Not Working. And they say this, I'm not saying I necessarily agree with this, but I think it will help, you know, sharpen our thinking. It is not obtaining supplies of labor that troubles ruling regimes around the world, but accommodating the demands and expectations of those who eagerly present their labor for sale, but find no takers. And that's very resonant, I think, with Mike Davis's book, Planet of Slums, brilliant book. And so they go on to say, large numbers of people are de facto a relative surplus population in the sense defined by Marx. However, if they die tomorrow, if they all died, or most of them, the rate of profit would remain unchanged. And the GNP would actually increase. That's a very brutal way of putting it, but it seems to me it makes us think. And the other quote is from Michael Burawoy, who's somebody who's very interested in commodification, draws to some extent on Polanyi, as Christoph has kind of outlined Polanyi and so on. And Burowoy says, in a recent article, if I can find it, sorry, I won't be too long, I hope. Burowoy says this, no, can't find it. Anyway, here we are. He talks about the decommodification of labour power in the current moment neoliberal globalization. A destructive decommodification of labour as it is pushed out of wage labour into the informal sector. Increasingly, exploitation is a privilege rather than a curse, especially in the South, but also in the North, with growing unemployment and underemployment. Now, I think again, he's focusing our attention on something, and something that strikes me as interesting and is rarely mentioned in these debates is the growth of the informal economy, so informalization of labor, a lot of which is actually wage labor, you know, often in disguised form. But certainly in Britain, and this is not new either, many workers or now redundant workers set up small businesses, you know, to try to survive. You know, I'm sure it's the same here in Slovenia. A Californian labor organizer once told me when we were talking about this, that workers at the Boeing aircraft plant, who he was organizing, they even did this at the same time as they had wage jobs because they wanted or needed more money. So combining wage labor and these petty enterprises is not all that new or all that novel in capitalism. Where I disagree with Burowoy is calling this a decommodification of labor. But I think, you know, again, the point is that the position of labor generally in the world today is more and more insecure. Any kind of regular secure employment is more and more scarce. Many people in what I call classes of labor have to resort to all sorts of means to get by. And that is an effect of current dynamics of capital, is not necessarily the result of some master plan by capital in general to squeeze more surplus value out of the workers there are, although it does many other things to try to ensure that, as Christoph reminded me.
Okay, any other comments, questions? Okay.
I just wanted to make a suggestion and ask for your comments about the about the placement of the chapter on primitive accumulation. Had he put it in the beginning of the book, it would have been much more popular, which is why he recommended Kugelman's wife to stop there. But I think it would have detracted from his scientific ambitions to talk about value theory. And I think once you got the primitive accumulation, I think people would be likely to fall into Joan Robinson's footsteps and say, what do we need value theory for?
Okay, any responses?
Okay, I agree.
Okay, any other questions? Comments? Of course.
When I was preparing for this wonderful school, I expected to be on the panel with Massimo De Angelis, who sadly couldn't be here. So I was expecting a really strong comradely fight on this panel. Well, Massimo unfortunately isn't here, so we haven't had that fight. But I am interested or curious to hear in the course of the coming days strong defenses of ideas of continuing primitive accumulation, of the David Harvey type position, of the autonomist positions argued by Massimo and others, because otherwise it's giving me this uncomfortable feeling that actually what I said is perhaps right, that we can do without the concept of primitive accumulation. And if we try to do so, I mean, that is in looking at contemporary capitalism, it will perhaps clear away some of the fog so that we can concentrate more clearly on grasping all the many complex and contradictory things that are happening now.
Great conclusion. Okay, any other questions, comments? If not, we're going to conclude this, and while I still have your attention, I would just like to point out that at 6 p.m. today, Andrew Kleiman has his keynote lecture on the topic of the incoherence of the transitional society as a Marxian concept. So please be there. I'm sure it's going to be a great lecture. Thank you again, and thank you to our speakers.